Everything is made up of tiny things called atoms. But how many atoms make up everything? I mean, how do you quantify invisible stitches that make up the fabric of our universe? How do you even count that high? One word, moles. This is one of the everythings made up of those tiny atoms. A nearly perfect sphere, 1 kilogram of a single crystal of silicon. So, how many atoms does it have? Well, like all crystals, the silicon sphere is made up of atoms in a regularly repeating fixed pattern. Using a mass spectrometer to calculate its molar mass, super powerful X-ray diffraction to measure the spacing of atoms, and laser interferometers to determine its volume, you can literally count the number of silicon atoms inside the sphere. And that number is 35.72759313 moles, give or take. But wait, how much is a mole of something? Well, 1 mole is Avogadro's number, named for this 19th century chemist. And that number is...
You just do the zero. You'll be the zero man.
I'll be the zero man?
Yeah, why not?
Oh, well, go ahead.
All right, so Avogadro's number is
602214076000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000
That's a little more than 600 billion trillion. Said another way, 6.02214076 times 10 to the 23rd. Here's the thing. That number is the redefined mole. Oh yeah, and while the mole is a number, it's really a unit of measurement. You see, in 1971, it joined the kilogram, the second, the meter, the candela, the ampere, and the kelvin as one of the seven base units in the International System of Units, the modern form of the metric system. And on May 20, 2019, the mole, along with three other units, was officially redefined thanks to the work of chemists Bob Vaki and Savelis Robb at the National Institute of Standards and Technology. Well, them and a whole international team of scientists. But before we get lost in all the zeros,
zero, 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 zero,
of old and
zero,
new moles,
zero, zero, zero,
let's take a step
zero,
back.
Zero,
what
zero,
is a mole?
Zero.
In one word, what is a mole?
In one word?
Yeah.
A unit.
A mole is...
one word.
6.022214076 times 10 to the 23rd entities.
So a mole is a unit. It's used for measuring really small things.
You need it to use it in order to change from, you know, molecules to grams of, you know, whatever compound that you were using. You always need to know, okay, moles of this or moles of that.
Moles are really practical. They translate things from the atomic level to quantities you can see and touch. Chemists use moles to design reactions that produce exactly the amount of a substance they need without ever having to actually count its atoms or molecules. It's like this. You don't count out grains of rice to go in a sushi roll. You measure rice using cups or grams. So the mole is a standard way of measuring quantities. But long ago, like before the metric system long ago, we didn't have standard ways of measuring anything. In fact, the story of the mole's redefinition starts way before it ever existed. It starts in France in the late 18th century.
We have, you know, kingdoms and counties and dukes and what have you. And all of these, they had different scales. So if you were a salesman and you sold cloth, for example, you crossed the county line and suddenly the yard was different. People at the time of the French Revolution thought this is actually not a good idea. We want to have a uniform measurement system that doesn't change, that's for all times and for all people, is the coinage that they used at the time.
Stefan Schlominger is a physicist at the National Institute of Standards and Technology. Oh, and he's wearing a hairnet because a kibble balance is right behind him.
Forgive me, this will be a little weird. Ready?
Awesome. There's no weirdness that I haven't had.
What's a kibble balance, you ask? It's this awesomely precise electromagnetic measuring instrument, precise enough that a strand of hair could upset its measurements. More on a kibble balance later. So what Schlominger is talking about...
A uniform measurement system. It's for all times of all people.
Is the creation of the metric system. Because in France alone, just prior to the revolution, it's estimated there were 250,000 different units of measurement in use. Okay, how does anybody start standardizing measurements? Well, you begin with a unit. Let's consider the kilogram. Early on, the kilogram was the mass of a liter of distilled water at its freezing point. Then, in 1799, a kilogram cylinder was forged from platinum, a physical you-can-hold-it-in-your-hand standard for the new metric system. In 1889, that prototype, dubbed Le Grand K, was reforged out of a platinum-iridium alloy to increase its stability. Also, it was locked in a vault. Oh, and what you're looking at here is K-20, the American national prototype. Made in 1889, it's an exact copy of Le Grand K. But that was 130 years ago. And what does all of this have to do with the redefinition of the mole?
I think when people said we want a measurement system for all times, for all people, I think it's a very noble idea. But I think they fell a little bit short of it. As everybody knows, things change. You know, this is a part of the basic human experience, right? You buy a new car, a couple years later, it doesn't look new anymore, right? So even this artifact kilogram, this international prototype of the kilogram, will change.
In fact, Le Grand K is getting lighter. Compared to its copies, like the American prototype, its mass is off by 50 micrograms. Think the weight of a grain of salt. So in 2011, the world's measurement experts came together and passed a resolution to redefine the kilogram. That's also when the decision was made to redefine the mole. Same with the Kelvin and Ampere. But redefined how?
In the new system of units, we're going to use fundamental constants of nature. They don't depend on time or space. No matter where you are, in the universe, you have the same value. No matter at what time you are there, you have the same value. They are sort of baked into the fabric of the universe.
So there's still a physical kilogram, but instead of a single object in a vault, the kilogram will be defined by Planck's constant, a number so small that it starts with 33 zeros after its decimal point. And you can find that number by dividing the amount of energy a particle of light carries by its electromagnetic frequency. But how does a tiny number and electromagnetic frequencies help us define the kilogram? That's where the Kibble balance comes in. It weighs an electromagnetic force against a mass, meaning in this case, it can tell you how much electromagnetic force is equal to a kilogram. And the answer is equal to Planck's constant. But there's another way to define a kilogram.
We have two different methods, and one method is the Kibble balance, and the other method is the silicon sphere.
Ladies and gentlemen, the mole. Redefined.
Mole is a relatively new unit. So when it was brought into the SI in 1971, it was defined on the basis of the kilogram.
Right there. That's the kilogram-mole connection. Because before the redefinition, a mole was equal to the number of atoms in 12 grams of carbon-12, which was about 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd atoms. That huge number represented the amount of elementary particles in a mole, meaning a mole was based around a number of components, not its size or what it weighs.
If we look at a mole of carbon and a mole of aluminum, they look different. And that's because this is packed in a very tight cubic structure. This is a more open structure. And so the volume has nothing to do with the number of entities there. It has to do with the crystalline structure.
Same number of atoms, different size package. The thing is, under the old definition of the mole,
we didn't know how many things were in a mole, but we knew what its mass was.
So the definition of a mole was maybe more complicated than it needed to be. That's why an international group of scientists decided to change things. Vaki and Rob are part of a worldwide team called the International Avogadro Project. Their mission, to measure the mole, aka Avogadro's number, as precisely as possible, and from there, redefine the mole.
But we knew the mass, but we didn't know the number of entities. What we've done is we flipped that on its head now, and we've defined the number of entities. We're, in effect, making something where we're counting atoms, which is about the most basic thing humans do. We've been counting things since Babylonian times.
Remember counting atoms in that silicon sphere? A sphere just like it redefined the mole. A sphere of silicon 28.
So the sphere that I was holding actually represents a kilogram. It's not necessarily a mole, but it can be used in order to determine what a mole of silicon is.
To make it, enriched silicon was grown into a purified crystal and shaped into this object, one of the most perfectly round things in the world. The scientists of the International Avogadro Project worked for years to figure out how to count each atom inside its curves. First, precise nanometer scale measurements of its volume. Then, a new set of technologies and methods to make an even trickier measurement, the space between atoms inside the silicon's crystalline structure.
If you have a volume and you have a grid inside it, you can count how many little things you have inside there. You can calculate it.
It's still abstract than saying, we are counting atoms. We can't see it visually, but the instrument can see it.
With these points of data, the researchers could calculate the total number of atoms in the sphere. Drumroll, please. The value of Avogadro's constant, the value of the mole, is now 6.02214076 times 10 to the 23rd. And now, a mole isn't determined by a kilogram. But that doesn't mean they're totally disconnected either.
Deep in physics, there's somewhere an equation that relates Avogadro's constant and Planck's constant together. So if you know one, you know the other. But the interesting thing is, this experiment that measured Avogadro's constant came more out of chemistry, and the experiment that measures Planck's constant came more out of physics. This is a miracle in itself that these two fields, like chemistry and physics, they're so big and wide that they can make an agreement. I think this is pretty amazing.
Just as a kilogram is now defined by a universal constant, so is the mole.
So you can take these measurements, put them in the, I'm not going to say magical equation, but into the equation to determine, okay, are we getting the same value for Avogadro's constant that someone else in another country or even in another lab, are they getting the same values? The measurements are available to anyone as long as they have the instrumentation, but it's available to get.
So why do universal constants for kilograms and moles even matter?
You have people that want to do fundamental research. They want, I want to discover the next new thing. Ours is not about discovering the next new thing. It's about making the measurement of that thing as accurate and as well characterized as possible for as many people as possible. The SI units are practical units. They're intended for commerce. And so everyone has to basically agree that this is the way they want to do it. They want to define it by a constant, and this is what the constant will be. Think about it nowadays. How often do we have unanimity in anything we do? This was, I think, special.